Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome to Health Matters on ITV with the Islamic Medical Association. I'm Dr. Shoayb Wadee, and today our guest is Professor Shabir Madhi, and we're going to be discussing vaccines and vaccination. But before we get to that, as is customary, as we usually do, we will have a little bit of an introduction and a small tarbiyah. So as we're discussing vaccinations, you know, one of the things I wanted to talk about is how do we vaccinate ourselves? How do we protect ourselves against things which are happening in the world, disasters which are happening in the world, the vagaries of fate? How do we protect ourselves from that? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us many, many different ways to protect ourselves, but I'm just going to give you two ways. The one way is to make constant shukr, to be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to constantly remind yourself of all the ni'mat which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. And by doing that, it is a manner of affording yourself protection against disaster and against bad things happening to you. The other way which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught us, and it's narrated in many hadith, is to recite parts of the Quran. And one of the easy things which people can do, and it's a practical thing, is to recite the last three quls, Surat al-Ikhlas, Surat al-Falaq, and Surat al-Nas, three times a day, three times in the morning and three times at night. And this has been narrated in many hadith by Rasulullah to say that this will give you protection from disasters and from tragedy which may befall you. So that's a way of vaccinating yourself from an Islamic perspective. And we're going to go now with Professor Madhi on what vaccination means and where the term comes from and what vaccination is about. But before we do that, just one last thing. I just want to, on behalf of the Islamic Medical Association and myself, we want to wish our brothers and sisters and our colleagues who are heading off to Gaza this evening as part of the Gift of the Givers team, together with Dr. Imtiaz Sulaimaan. They're heading off to perform a mission on behalf of all South Africans, really, a mission, a humanitarian mission, a mission to help the people in Gaza with healthcare needs. They're going with 15 million rands worth of equipment and supplies. They're going with a team of 10 doctors, which is all that they've been allowed to take. And we wish them well. We pray that they come back safely, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants them safety and success in their mission. And we pray that there's peace in the area and peace overall for the people of Gaza, so that they can get back to a productive and healthy and a good life. And inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will hear our du'as. So now we get on to Professor Madhi. Assalamu alaikum. How are you, Shabir?
Wa alaikum assalam.
Thanks for joining us today on ITV. As I mentioned, we're going to be discussing vaccination, right, and vaccines. So maybe you want to just give us a bit of a background, because, you know, vaccines, I come from a different background. So for me, a vaccine is something you get and then you forget.
Well, you probably wouldn't have forgotten it, because the one of your first experiences, and in fact, one of the first experiences of most children with healthcare facilities, is when they actually get vaccinated as early as birth.
Right.
So in South Africa, as an example, as soon as a child is born, before the child is even allowed to take his first gasp of air, he almost gets his first shot of vaccine, and that is a vaccine against tuberculosis.
Right.
And then there's also vaccines against polio. But what is vaccines all about? So perhaps what we should do is just go step a little back. Let's get some history about vaccines. So the first vaccine, in fact, was really discovered way back in the 1700s, almost 300 years ago now.
All right.
And it was a very interesting case, in that what they basically looked at is that there was this disease known as smallpox,
right,
a very severe, severe disease.
Right, right.
And it used to kill literally millions of people each year from this disease called smallpox. And there was this a young chap. He was 14 years old when he actually started to be an apprentice to a surgeon. His name was Edward Jenner.
Right.
And what he actually realized, he had this observation that there was another disease known as cowpox. And cowpox is something which milkmaids usually used to get on their arms when they used to milk the cows. But Edward Jenner noticed that the people that were getting cowpox didn't actually contract smallpox.
Right, right.
So this sort of stimulated some thought in his mind, and he did something which probably wouldn't muster any sort of ethical approval in this day and age.
Right.
So what Edward basically did is that he decided to do an experiment.
Right.
And he actually did this experiment on a little boy, an 8-year-old boy, who was actually the son of the gardener,
right,
of his gardener.
Okay. Okay.
And what Edward basically did...
Don't try that now.
We shouldn't try that, yeah. Definitely not. And certainly that's not the way we operate in this day and, sure. day and age. But these were the times when there was very little happening in the way of,
right.
in the field
research,
of medicine,
yeah.
and in the field of medicine. So anyway, what Edward did is that he came across a milk lady who basically had cowpox. She had pustules all in her arms.
Right.
He sort of opened up one of his pustules, took some of the pus out, and actually injected this poor little boy, this 8-year-old boy,
okay.
with this material from this
pustule.
What happened? The boy developed a few pustules, but didn't become very sick. And then what Edward basically did is he actually took smallpox virus from someone that actually has smallpox,
right,
and hopefully
right.
we'll be able to show you a picture of what smallpox is.
I think we've got some pictures.
We've got pictures.
Yeah.
And it will really give you an idea as to what sort of a devastating illness it was.
Right.
But nevertheless, what he did, and that's exactly the picture that we're seeing, what he basically did is he took some pus from the smallpox pustules now,
yeah,
injected the boy, and one would have expected the boy to actually become sick.
Yes.
But you know what? The boy didn't actually become sick.
Okay, because it had cowpox.
So that's really the discovery behind how okay. vaccines actually work.
So the cowpox was protecting him from the smallpox
exactly,
in some way.
Exactly.
Okay.
So what vaccines are all about is that it takes a bacteria or a virus,
right.
a germ. It either weakens the germ,
okay.
or it takes a germ which is very similarly related to another germ,
right.
or it
right.
takes a piece of that particular bacteria
right.
or virus,
okay.
and then it uses that to basically get a body to actually mount what we call an immune response.
Right. So your immune system, which normally protects you from infections
Correct.
And protects you from cancers and other things, it stimulates it.
Exactly.
Wakes
so,
it up.
Exactly. So in our blood, we've got these white blood cells which are right. circulating all over the show.
Yeah, yeah.
And basically, when they come across a foreign substance, what they basically do, it triggers the white cells to actually respond to
right,
that infection
right,
to try
right,
to protect
right.
the body.
Right.
Now, what vaccines does is that it sort of artificially induces or accelerates the manner in which the body actually develops a sort of immune response.
Right, right.
So when you use this piece of the small component of a germ or an inactivated component or a weakened form of the germ, you inject it in a person or sometimes you give it orally,
right.
what it does is that the body responds to it, the white blood cells then start to produce antibodies.
Okay.
Now these antibodies are sort of the soldiers in the blood.
Okay.
Right? They're the soldiers in the blood.
They're not cells.
They're not cells.
Yeah.
They're produced by the white cells,
right.
but they're not cells themselves.
They're like pieces of protein. And
exactly,
whatnot,
protein.
Yeah.
So they're sort of the particles which sort of move around in the body. And as soon as that same germ in its natural wild form actually enters the
right,
body,
right.
what the soldiers are able to do is basically kill off those
right,
germs.
Right.
And that's what vaccine is all about.
Okay.
It's basically being able to get the body to actually be prepared
right.
to actually meet germs which are actually harmful to the body
yeah.
if it's acquired in its natural state.
So to use like a military analogy, it's like getting the right weapons and keeping them in stock
exactly.
way beforehand so that
exactly.
if that enemy comes back again in its full force, you're ready for them.
Exactly.
Okay.
That's it.
I mean, certainly, I'm sure people have noticed in their own lives that the formation and the effect of antibodies is that if you've had measles, for example, or you have chickenpox, you don't get it again in general. I mean, there are some exceptions, but you don't get it again in the same form, and that's partly because your body has formed an immune response to that virus.
Exactly. So what vaccination is all about is trying to avoid the person actually
getting
acquiring the disease
right.
as the natural form of inducing immunity.
Right. Right.
And the reason why that's important is that for many viruses, for many bacteria. If a person actually gets a natural infection,
you don't survive it, or you have
complications. You might not survive it.
Yes.
So,
yeah.
in this day and age, we're actually fortunate. We're right. fortunate in that there's been huge advances in the field of vaccines.
Right.
So many diseases which really affected people not many years ago, not right. even 20, 30 years ago,
yeah.
which was devastating in terms of the impact it had on society,
yeah.
are no longer with us.
So how many people does smallpox kill today, Shabir?
So smallpox is one of the most remarkable
yeah.
success stories of medical history.
Yeah.
In the 1700s, in the 1800s, in the 1900s, millions of people literally each year were killed by smallpox.
There was no treatment.
There was no treatment whatsoever. So
yeah.
millions of people, and we saw what a devastating illness it is. I mean, the really, really entire body covered with this.
Incapacitating
this infection, this becoming infected with bacteria, and people literally
and it could
die.
Affect relatively young people, productive people.
Affecting very young people. I mean, you can see in this particular example, someone in his mid-20s, mid-30s, and it was very contagious.
Yes.
So someone that comes into contact with someone with that type of lesions
right.
would actually become infected himself. So it was
okay.
a very contagious disease. But what happened is that we actually managed to eradicate smallpox,
right.
Really eradicate it. So there hasn't been one case of smallpox since the late 1970s. And that's really a remarkable feat in terms of what vaccines are able to achieve and how it's actually able to improve the health of humanity.
Yes. So, I mean, by vaccinating, we don't vaccinate for smallpox anymore.
We don't need to anymore because the virus doesn't circulate any longer.
Doesn't circulate anymore. So that's one of the ways which the vaccine can work. What are the other conditions that we commonly vaccinate? I mean, kids get a routine of vaccinations.
Okay.
In South Africa, obviously, it may differ. Yeah. In different areas of the world, depending on the needs of the community. But what's the South African schedule?
So, I mean, I think in South Africa, we really don't appreciate just how fortunate our children are.
Right.
The children in South Africa actually receive what is considered to be amongst the best schedule of vaccines compared to anywhere else in the world.
Right.
South Africa, as an example, was the first country in the whole of Africa, and in fact, the first country in any low-middle income country which actually introduced two very important vaccines very recently into the childhood immunization program. And I think anyone that has heard any radio commercials on vaccines would have heard this pneumococcal vaccine.
Right.
Now, the pneumococcal conjugate vaccine, which was introduced in South Africa in April 2009, is basically a vaccine which is aimed at protecting children against very, very common diseases and also diseases which are associated with many children dying, not only in South Africa, but globally.
So that's pneumococcus.
Pneumococcus. And the type of diseases which a pneumococcus protects against is chest infections, pneumonia, severe pneumonia, brain infections,
meningitis,
and ear infections.
Right.
But many children, actually globally, roughly about 700,000 children will die because of pneumococcal disease.
Every year.
Sure. Every year.
That's around the world.
Around the world. And the reason why those children are dying is that unlike the children in South Africa who are fortunate enough to actually receive this really expensive vaccine free of charge through the public health sector, in most parts, in many low and middle income countries, this vaccine is simply not affordable. So that's a pneumococcal vaccine. Another important vaccine that was introduced into our immunization
program. What's the name of this vaccine, the pneumococcal
vaccine? The pneumococcal vaccine is known as a pneumococcal conjugate vaccine.
Right.
In South Africa, there's two different formulations.
Yeah.
In South Africa, we use Prevnar 13.
Right.
And that is really the top of the range in terms of pneumococcal vaccination.
And that's only been introduced as a...
As I mentioned, it's since April 2009.
If your child was not vaccinated, born after April 2009, would you recommend they get that vaccination? I mean, obviously, not every child is susceptible to pneumococcal vaccine. There's a window, maybe, which they're more susceptible to than when they're not.
So the most severe form of pneumococcal disease occurs in the first 1 or 2 years of life. So any child that has been born since 2009, if they received the other vaccines, very likely have received this vaccine. There are other high-risk children, older children, that are also predisposed to developing pneumococcal disease. As an example, children with asthma. Or children with thalassemias, with sickle cell disease, uncommon diseases, or children with cancers, as an example.
So the immune system is relatively suppressed
for
many different reasons.
And if those children, I mean, we're in the year 2014, so if children are 6 years and above, they may not have received a pneumococcal conjugate vaccine, but if they got these underlying conditions which predispose them to pneumococcal disease, then certainly the doctors, nurses should be considering having those children vaccinated.
And will they get that in the state public sector as well?
So
access to that?
On a motivational basis, you'd probably be able to get them vaccinated. I mean, I think the South African immunization program is really pro-vaccination.
Sure.
It's not about trying to create hurdles in getting children vaccinated. It's really trying to be
inclusive
and capacitating in terms of having people vaccinated.
Okay, so you're going on after pneumococcal?
So another important vaccine, and I'll come quickly to the schedule just now, but another notable vaccine which I probably should mention, which was again introduced in August 2009 in South Africa, is a vaccine known as rotavirus vaccine.
Right.
Now, rotavirus is the most important cause of diarrheal disease, of gastroenteritis, vomiting, diarrhea, especially in very young children.
Okay, is this around the world?
Globally. Okay. So about 40% of all children, in absence of rotavirus vaccine, about 40% of all children that are hospitalized with diarrheal disease would be because of rotavirus.
Sure.
Exactly.
Okay.
And it's a very seasonal disease. Now,
occurs mostly in summer?
Mainly in summer, correct. In fact, we're just right in the midst of our sort of spring summer in South Africa. So right now, the rotavirus season has really started in South Africa.
Okay.
Now, rotavirus, as an example, causes 450,000 children to die each year.
Sure.
Right? Now, this is something that children shouldn't be dying from.
Diarrhea,
because diarrheal disease is something that is easily treated. If you've got a simple sugar and salt solution with clean water, children shouldn't be dying of viral disease. Sure. But the reality of our life is that there's huge imperatives in terms of access to healthcare, even basic healthcare, such as access to clean water and sugar and salt solution. Absolutely. And that's the reason why children die from viral disease. So 450,000 children will die of rotavirus itself in absence of vaccination.
After that, let's just hold that thought because that's a big, big number. We're going to go to an ad break, but just to give the callers the phone number, they can call us after the ad break and then we'll discuss a bit more about diarrheal disease as well. But the number is 011-086-7700 and we're going to go to an ad break and we get back. We'll discuss a bit more and we'll take some of your calls, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh and welcome back to ITV and Health Matters. We're speaking to Professor Shabir Madhi about vaccinations and disease which may be impacted and assisted with vaccinations and some of the principles around vaccination. As I mentioned before the break that you're welcome to call. Our number is 011-086-7700 with any questions for Professor Madhi and we'll be happy to answer them inshallah. Prof, we were discussing about rotavirus and diarrhea.
Yeah.
So I cut you off mid-sentence there. You said there's 450,000 kids, am I right?
Exactly.
I forget the number, so, who die every year from diarrheal diseases.
Exactly. So 450,000 children will die of diarrheal disease just because of rotavirus.
Sure.
And that's more
phenomenal.
Children that will die because of other causes. So the rotavirus vaccine, like I mentioned, was introduced into the South African public immunization program as of August 2009. And children will get a vaccine. There's two doses of vaccine. The first dose is given at 6 weeks of age,
right,
and the second dose at 14 weeks of
age.
Is
the injection?
And this
or
is
oral.
A vaccine that's actually
oral,
given orally. So it's the only vaccine, besides the polio vaccine, that's also given orally at 6 weeks, but the only other vaccine that's given orally.
Why are these vaccines given orally? Just because they're more effective? Is that where they need to work?
Well,
there's
a
normal
good
source of entry of these
there's
viruses.
There's two different reasons. So one reason is that when we give vaccines orally, what it's able to do is induce what we call gut immunity.
Right.
So the immune system in the intestines is basically able to react.
So you've got almost a compartment in your indices, in your intestines of your immune system, which works almost independently.
Yeah.
In some
and ways. Especially for diseases which are acquired in the enteric route
through the gut
itself.
Like polio is another
example. We prefer to actually vaccinate by getting gut immunity.
So you stop it at the entry point.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
So like I said, they're given at 6 weeks and 14 weeks of age. And you won't believe me, but when I say that there's, in my 25 years as a pediatrician, I haven't seen as remarkable an impact with one single intervention as I've seen with rotavirus.
So it's making the pediatric wards quiet.
Some of the gastroenteritis wards in many of our public hospitals have actually literally been closed down. They've been shut down.
So the pediatricians have better moods these days.
Well, not too much with me because I've taken away their business. But the diarrheal wards have really, there's been about a 40 to 60% reduction in hospitalization for diarrheal disease.
I mean, I did a short stint in pediatrics, and to put into perspective, about half your patients in general on any admission were just related to diarrhea, especially during the spring, summer season. It's unbelievable.
Exactly.
So that would have a huge impact on healthcare.
And I mean, globally, the experience with this vaccine has been that by vaccinating children, you're able to reduce all-cause diarrheal death by 40% as well.
Sure. I mean, that's just unbelievable.
This is a remarkable achievement. Yeah. So I think the rotavirus has been a great achievement. But Shoayb, perhaps just to take a step back. So I think it's just important just to reemphasize what vaccines are given and at what ages.
Yeah.
So like I said, in South Africa, the vaccine schedule is that at the time of birth, children will get a BCG vaccine. That's a shot in the arm.
TB.
And that's for TB.
Right.
And they would get oral drops of polio vaccine.
Right.
At 6 weeks.
So that's just before they even leave the hospital.
Before they leave the hospital. Right. Every child is meant to be vaccinated to those two vaccines before they leave the hospital. At 6 weeks of age, they'll again get oral drops of polio vaccine, but then they'll get three injections.
Okay.
The one injection is a combination of vaccines for whooping cough, for tetanus, and for diphtheria.
Okay.
So those are diseases. Whooping cough is a disease we still see occasionally, but other two diseases we don't see much of it simply because of how well we vaccinate against it. In addition,
and obviously they were deadly diseases
in
the past.
So, I mean, as an example with tetanus, in 1988, 750,000 babies in the first month of life would have died of tetanus.
And they acquire it during childbirth.
They actually,
process.
After they're born, yeah. and immediately during the child because of some cultural practice.
And trauma, yeah.
Exactly. So 750,000 children would have died of tetanus.
Right.
In this day and age, it's less than 50,000. Simply, what we've done now is that in addition to vaccinating the children, women, when they are pregnant, also get a tetanus vaccine. Sure. And that antibody is transferred from the mother to the baby while the baby is still in the womb. Sure. And the baby is actually naturally protected by the time the baby is born.
I mean, these are diseases which were commonplace before.
Exactly.
You rarely see them now.
And so what you see here is also whooping cough. Yeah. Now, whooping cough, unfortunately, is a disease we still see occasionally.
Right.
But it's a really devastating disease. In this particular child, you would think that the child has actually been abused.
Been hit.
But in fact, what's happening with the child is coughing so hard that he's actually starting to bleed into his eyes, under his skin.
And obviously this leads to either death or permanent lung damage frequently.
The children that have severe forms of whooping cough, they actually almost suffocate because they're coughing so severely that they can't actually breathe in.
Yeah.
And it can actually cause bleeding around the brain also. So whooping cough is another devastating illness. So like I said, in South Africa, we vaccinate for whooping cough, tetanus, diphtheria, Haemophilus influenza type B, which is a bacteria that causes meningitis, infection around the brain. And then we also give the pneumococcal vaccine at 6 weeks of age.
So
and
that's also, these are all at 6 weeks?
All at 6 weeks, and hepatitis B vaccine.
Okay.
So there's three different vaccines, three injections, but we basically covering
like
about
diseases.
seven, eight diseases, correct.
Okay. And we're going to get back, there's a caller online, and once we've taken the caller, we'll get back. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam. I just like to ask the prof a question. My grandchild is 13 months old, and she was hospitalized, and the test came through that she had rotavirus. I know she didn't get the drops at all, so is it too late for her, or what can we do?
Yeah, so thanks for the question. It's really unfortunate that she didn't get the drops. And unfortunately, one of the challenges that we face with rotavirus vaccine is that at some of the healthcare facilities, there have been shortages now and then. Unfortunately, with the rotavirus vaccine, is that there is an age limit up to when you can actually give the rotavirus vaccine. And that is roughly about up to 24 to 36 weeks after the child is born. So if the child is already 13 months, it's too late to give the rotavirus vaccine. But the good news is that when a child develops natural rotavirus infection, that child subsequently develops immunity. So it's unlikely that a child will get another episode of rotavirus viral disease.
So the child needs to be well looked after during this episode
correct.
Of rotavirus.
Yeah. So I'm sure the child has recovered, but like I said, it's too late for the child to get the rotavirus vaccine, but it's unlikely the child will develop a severe form of rotavirus disease again, simply because it got a natural infection, which itself also induces immunity.
So her immune system will fight whatever it is the next time.
It will, if she's exposed to rotavirus again, certainly her immune system will be able to combat the virus.
So there's nothing else one can give her besides the injection?
Yeah. Look, so there's absolutely nothing else for viral disease that you can actually provide in terms of vaccination. The most important thing about viral disease is really just to be vigilant to ensure that children are actually getting adequate fluids when they have the viral disease. And like I mentioned, it's something as simple as taking 8 teaspoons of sugar, 1 level teaspoon of salt, mixing it in a liter of water, and actually giving the child about 1 cup after every stool. And that's really the way to treat viral disease. But in terms of vaccination, the vaccination needs to take place at a very early stage, at 6 weeks and 14 weeks in South Africa. And we wouldn't recommend a catch-up dose of vaccine for older children.
And Professor, if she hasn't had any other vaccines, can she have those vaccines now?
If she hasn't had any other vaccine, it's absolutely essential
that
you take her to the clinic to catch up with her vaccines.
Okay.
Anyone that's not actually taking children to be vaccinated is almost gambling. It's literally gambling. You're gambling with the health of children, right?
Okay.
And it's really, really absolutely essential that they should be taken for vaccination.
And, I mean, it's not just your own child that you're putting at risk. You may be putting other children at risk as well. Because, I mean, unfortunately, not every single vaccine is going to be completely successful. But as long as a majority of the population is covered, the risk of there being an outbreak or the disease spreading is very, very small. Maybe let's go to measles, because I'm sure that's the next vaccine which is coming up on your list there. And it's a big one, and it's been a problem in the past.
Yeah. So measles is a good example of what you just described just now, that none of the vaccines that we've got 100% efficacious. That is, there's no vaccine that can lay claim that they'll prevent all the disease from that vaccine. Unfortunately, in any given population, there are a few children that won't mount an adequate response to a vaccine, and those children will remain susceptible to the disease. But for many of the vaccines we use nowadays, they're highly efficacious. But there are a few children that will not mount an immune response.
I mean, there's nothing in life which is guaranteed. You're not going to wake up in the morning and every day your car is going to start.
Correct.
You're not going to get them in a Malaysia Airlines flight and reach your destination every time.
Exactly.
So Allah knows when it's going to be successful, but vaccines are similar.
Right. So measles is a vaccine which is an example of a vaccine that's actually produced by taking the measles virus itself, what we call a weakened form of the virus,
right?
And then we use that as the actual vaccine.
So it's a live
attenuated vaccine.
Virus.
Correct.
Okay.
A person really becomes ill from the injection itself. It's a live attenuated vaccine. And in South Africa, we give the measles vaccine at 9 months and 18 months.
Okay.
But so with measles, basically, the story is not many years ago, in fact, 10 years ago, in the year 2000, over half a million children would have died of measles.
In the world?
In the world. And almost 70% of that actually happened in Africa.
That's 15 years ago, 14 years ago.
Exactly, 14 years ago, right? Yeah. And now measles vaccine is a vaccine that was discovered not yesterday, but it was discovered way back in the 1970s.
Sure.
Yes, 30 years after the vaccine was discovered, almost half a million of children were dying each year. And the reason for that is that we weren't adequately vaccinating children against measles. So when children are vaccinated against measles, the vaccine is highly efficacious.
Right.
If a child has been vaccinated against measles, it's unlikely that child is going to develop measles,
right,
even if there's an outbreak of measles.
Right.
But the challenge that we face with measles is that for there to be community-wide protection against measles, almost 98% of the population needs to be vaccinated.
Okay.
If you're not at 98%, you're going to get occasional outbreaks every 4 to 5 years.
Right.
Now, what does measles cause? We've seen here just this child with a severe rash. But
I think that's what some people think. It's just a rash and a bit of a fever.
This is a good spectrum of the illness where you just have this rash.
Yeah.
In fact, the reason why children die from measles, as I mentioned, half a million children dying from measles, is not because of this rash. It's because the virus actually can cause pneumonia. Right? And unfortunately, if a person has got measles pneumonia, there's absolutely no treatment that we've actually got to actually treat that measles
pneumonia. There's no antibiotic for measles.
Some of the children have a superimposed bacterial infection, which we can treat. But if the pneumonia itself is truly because of the measles virus, there's no antivirals or antibiotics we can actually treat that. And that's the reason why, when I was a pediatrician, when I was training as a pediatrician, in the early 1990s, we used to see many children die of measles, and it was something that was completely preventable, avoidable, if children had just simply received the vaccine.
I mean, this is really a case where prevention is better than cure.
Exactly.
I mean, besides the complications of measles, which admittedly not every child is going to get a complication of measles. Some children will just get the rash, but there are many other complications which kids with measles can get, post-measles, neurological complications.
They can get encephalitis, At the end of the day, I don't think you want to take the chance that, so the complication rate might be about 5% of all measles cases are severe, but you don't want your child to be one of the 20 cases that's actually going
and
to
develop. And also with a disease that's not treatable in any way.
That's not treatable,
really. So I think in this case, really, measles is... And the reason that we bring measles up is because, obviously, it's been at the center of lots of controversy. We're just going to go to our second ad break, but as soon as we get back from the ad break, I think we're going to discuss some of the controversies around vaccines and where they've come from and what really we should be taking from those controversies. So we're going to go to our second ad break, and then we'll be back, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back to Health Matters with the Islamic Medical Association on ITV. Just to remind you of the number to call if you have any questions, it's 011-086-7700. So let's get back to what we were discussing, Prof. We were discussing measles and some of the controversies which have been around vaccination, and they're really centered on measles, particularly some of it on polio and so forth and so on. Can you just go through some of them and maybe tell us
so I think the controversy,
where they come from? Yeah.
Right. So the controversy you're referring to is actually not with measles, but with mumps, vaccines. So the measles, in some countries, the measles vaccine is given together with mumps and rubella, two other
MMR.
Vaccines. MMR, correct.
Right.
So some years ago in the United Kingdom, there was a report by a physician, a pediatrician, who basically claimed that there was an association between mumps vaccination and autism. But since then, that person actually has been expelled from the medical fraternity in the United Kingdom because it was identified that he actually falsified his research.
Okay.
But he created a tremendous amount of harm in terms of the public perception of the safety of vaccines. So to date now, with all of the evidence having been reviewed, there's definitely absolutely no association between mumps vaccination and autism, correct.
Yeah. Okay. But I mean, obviously, there's still, if you go on the internet, there's groups who say no to vaccination. Vaccination causes problems. It makes you sicker than the actual disease and causes autoimmune conditions and so on. But really, there's no evidence, credible evidence to back up any of those.
So, Shoaib, I think you're raising a very important point. And that is, fortunately and unfortunately, is that many of these people that are anti-vaccine, the anti-vaccine lobby, are people that generally come from upper middle and higher socioeconomic backgrounds, right? And they can sit in the comfort of their homes knowing that if someone in their family becomes ill, they'll be able to take that person to a healthcare facility.
So they get diarrhea, they're unlikely to die from it.
They're not going to die from it.
Sure.
The people that tend to benefit the greatest from vaccines are those people that come from low socioeconomic conditions.
Right.
The people that have had very limited access to curative healthcare services.
Sure.
And those are the people that suffer the brunt of infectious disease, morbidity, and mortality. So it's very easy for someone from Sandton or from Constantia in the Cape or Hermanus to basically be critical about vaccination without really realizing the potential impact and the impact which vaccines actually have had in improving the lives of people that come from the most marginalized of communities.
Especially if they're vocally critical and
make
it a big issue and convince people from those communities that, you know, it's not a good thing to do. And I think that's really the crux of the anti-vaccine lobby. A lot of it is the information is drawn out from poor quality scientific evidence, and it's hyped up, especially on the internet.
Exactly. So there's nothing that sells media more than stirring
and
some
controversy.
And conspiracy, exactly.
Yeah, you know.
And I think that's what we face with in terms of people that are anti-vaccines.
I mean, having said that, some conspiracy theorists are correct, and we were discussing off-air the recent case in Pakistan where the CIA was using some of the vaccination drives to target some of the activities in Pakistan.
Exactly. That's
really counterproductive.
That was completely irresponsible of the U.S. government to use vaccines, something which is meant to save the lives of people, and to create this amount of distrust by using it as a tool to actually serve their own agenda is something which is completely unacceptable.
We have another caller on the line. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam.
How can we help you, sister? Do you have a question?
Gee, I have a question. I took my child for the chickenpox vaccine, but unfortunately, I can't get hold of it. What do I do about that?
Right. So the chickenpox vaccine is a vaccine that's not part of the public immunization program. It's a vaccine that you would need to procure in private. And the reason for that is that chickenpox does cause illness but doesn't cause too severe disease in children. Unfortunately, the problem with chickenpox vaccine in South Africa right now is that there has been a shortage of vaccine for almost over a year now. And that is something which the only people that can answer to it are the manufacturers that actually produce a vaccine. But like I said, fortunately, hopefully your child has been vaccinated against all of the other vaccines. So chickenpox is a good to have vaccine. But if the child doesn't get it, I wouldn't be too concerned. Even if the child does get chickenpox, it doesn't cause the type of complications we've been discussing in most instances. So usually the child...
Okay, it's not too serious.
Correct. So I wouldn't be too concerned that the child hasn't been vaccinated, but should a vaccine become available during the course of the next few months, it would be a good-to-have vaccine for the child to be vaccinated with.
Okay, jazakallah.
I think, sister, the concern with chickenpox that many people have is that it causes cosmetic problems with the healing of the scars and so forth and so on. So I think if the child does get chickenpox, the important thing is to make sure that it's looked after properly.
Okay.
You know, and some of those complications can be prevented. So inshallah, you know, it can be mitigated and will not be a big problem.
Okay, jazakallah.
Okay. So Shabir, let's get back to, we were discussing some of the controversies and we mentioned, some of the problems around them. I mean, but obviously, I don't think there's anything that's 100% safe. There are people who are going to get problems with vaccines. It's inevitable. There are people who are going to get problems walking down the stairs. You know, so I mean, can you, what are the, some of the complications? And maybe just tell us how often they occur.
Right. So, Shoayb, you're completely right. There's no, even if you take an antibiotic, all antibiotics come with the side effect.
Sure.
Right. So there's no medical intervention that doesn't have some sort of side effect. And the real issue is being able to balance the risk compared to the benefits.
Right.
And that's really where we stand. Right. Now, I think what we need to be clear about in terms of vaccines is that there isn't any other pharmaceutical product that's probably as heavily regulated as vaccines.
Right.
And the reason for that is that we are giving completely healthy children
something
which could benefit a child but could also cause harm.
Right.
So for any vaccine to actually to be registered, the first and foremost thing that you actually need to prove is to establish the safety of the vaccine.
Right.
Before you even show that the vaccine works, you need to show that the vaccine is actually safe.
Okay.
Right. So all of the vaccines that we've got, at least all of the vaccines that have been licensed since the 1980s, right, those vaccines have been interrogated in terms of its safety.
And you can't test vaccines on animals, obviously. You've got to test them on humans.
Yeah. So we start off with animals, but animals are not humans. So eventually the end game is to be able to test it in humans, and especially in the target age group to which it's actually meant for. So what are the side effects of vaccines? Now, like I said, vaccines, you're basically giving, in some instances, a weakened form of the germ or a component of germ, and usually you give it as an injection.
Right.
And if you give anyone an injection, there's going to be a side effect. A common side effect is you're going to have pain at the site of injection. Right? Occasionally, you might have a bit of swelling around that area.
Right.
So the TB vaccine, as an example, is a good example where when you give that injection, many small children will actually start developing a pustule there.
They
have some pus there.
Yeah.
And what that actually tells us is that the immune system is actually responding to the vaccine.
Attacking the antigens.
Exactly. So as part of the immune system response to the vaccine, you're actually getting some sort of a systemic reaction.
Right.
Right. So you get local induration, you get redness in the area, and sometimes you might actually get a mild fever. So the common side effects of injectable vaccines are basically injection site induration, tenderness, redness, and a mild fever. But a fever usually is very mild. It doesn't go above 38 degrees Celsius, which is when we really become concerned about the fever.
So there's no risk of sort of febrile seizures or seizures in young kids related to vaccines?
It's not that there's no risk. It's that it's a really rare complication, a very rare complication.
Okay.
So, I mean, in my 20 years, 25 years of researching vaccines, to be honest, I haven't come across one single case where a child has actually developed a febrile seizure because
of the vaccine.
There have been some vaccines that have caused that, and those vaccines are no longer in use.
Okay.
Right? But essentially, with the vaccines that we use, and the vaccine that used to cause quite a bit of side effects is the vaccine for whooping cough, which was where we were using the whole cell vaccine.
Right.
But that's a vaccine which we no longer use in South Africa. So we, for whooping cough, we've changed to a different formulation, which is much less reactogenic.
Okay. Okay.
So that sort of severe side effects have become much less.
Is there a risk of allergy to vaccine?
Look, there was always this concern that before your child gets measles vaccine, you need to give your child some egg.
Yeah.
Because the formulation of these vaccines are egg-based in instances.
Right, right. They're grown on an egg-based culture.
Correct, yeah, they're cultured. But essentially, I mean, again, there's nothing that you can say with 100% certainty that there will be absolutely no allergic reaction.
But it's rare.
Right, but it's extremely rare. Again, I've never seen a severe allergic reaction to any vaccine.
Okay. And I mean, are there any other, you know, concerns which people may have? Maybe people are thinking that vaccines are grown on pig cells or they're not halal or, there's no basis to any of those.
Look, most of the vaccines that we use are really synthetic based now. Right, which is to say that they're actually constructed from the start to the end, almost free of what we call animal cell lines.
Right.
There are some vaccines that still use animal cell lines, but the majority of vaccines don't use animal cell lines any longer.
No, I mean I think just to give clarity to people that there's from an Islamic perspective, there's no impediment to being vaccinated, and even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made many means of protecting us in the Quran and in other ways, we should always, and even though we place our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we should always make sure we take responsibility for those around. So we tie our camel. When you go and sit in your car, you close the door, you put on your seatbelt, you make sure your brakes are working, so forth and so on. You don't just go close your eyes and drive. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us these faculties. And vaccines are not Didn't drop out of the sky. They are a ni'mat and gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I think for those of us who are wondering, you know, we should just trust Allah. I think we need to realize that these things come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well. And we, as human beings, have been allowed to develop them and use them. Shabir, let's go back to some of the other vaccines. One of the other big vaccines which has made a huge difference in South Africa is hepatitis B.
Right. Yeah. So hepatitis B is a good example of a vaccine which we give at a very early stage to protect people at a much later stage in life. So in 1980s in South Africa, the leading cause of cancer in men was what we call cancer of the liver, hepatocellular carcinoma, a devastating illness. There's no cure for it. There's no treatment for it. People literally used to die by the dozens on a daily basis because of hepatocellular carcinoma. And what we know about hepatocellular carcinoma is that the cause of hepatocellular carcinoma or liver cancer is actually hepatitis B virus.
Most of the times
it's hepatitis B virus. So now what happened since the early 1990s is all children in South Africa receive hepatitis B vaccine. That's one of the three vaccines that they get at 6, 10, and 14 weeks. And by vaccinating children just at 6, 10, and 14 weeks, you're almost giving them lifelong protection against hepatitis B illness.
We've got another caller. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Shoayb.
Is this Uncle Ibi?
Ji.
How are you, Uncle Ibi? Do you have a question for us?
Ji, you know what? I'm sorry that it's unrelated to your subject, but I thought I'll just mention that we're having a health screening day in Azadville on Sunday.
Okay.
And people are welcome to come, especially the local residents in our vicinity. Starts at 8:30 to 2 o'clock. And we'll have a few specialists also on duty.
So that's for the residents of Azadville. This is Dr. Ibi Muhammad just reminding us that they've got a health screening day, not a health screening day. So if you want to scream, you have to go somewhere else. But if you want some screening done to look at your blood pressure, your cholesterol, your sugar, and you want to put some questions to some of the specialists, please feel free. It's at the Civic Center, Uncle Ibi. Okay. Between 10 and 2, you said?
Between 8:30
and 2. 8:30 and 2 on Sunday?
On Sunday.
Jazakallah khair. And thanks for that information, Uncle Ibi.
Shukran, Shabir.
Okay.
Shoayb, thank you. Jazakallah.
Okay. So just to get back, Shabir, that's a bit off topic, but so we were discussing hepatitis B.
Yeah, so like I said, we still see a few cancers, but we rarely see as much, we don't see as many
cases
of hepatitis, of liver cancer.
And cirrhosis as we did in the past, and hepatitis cirrhosis, B.
Correct.
I mean, so that's really made a big change to the healthcare sector in South Africa with quite a simple, successful intervention. What about cancer of the cervix, Shabir?
So this is another example of cancer being directly associated with a virus, an infection. And cancer of the cervix in South Africa amongst women, it's the number one cause of cancer in South African women. Probably as common as breast cancer, if not more common than breast cancer. But the difference between breast cancer and cancer of the cervix is that now we've got the tools to actually prevent cancer of the cervix. And the tool that we've got is that we know that the majority of cases of cancer of the cervix is actually caused by a virus known as a human papilloma virus.
HPV.
Exactly. And so again, South Africa became almost the first country in all of Africa to introduce the HPV vaccine into the immunization program. But unlike the other vaccines which are given at a very young age, the HPV vaccine is targeted to children at about 10 years of age that are going to school. So on an annual basis now, what will be happening is that the Department of Health will be going out to schools to vaccinate all children, in grade 4. With HPV vaccine, they need to get two vaccines, which are spaced about 6 months apart.
Because usually HPV is sexually transmissible.
Correct.
So before these kids become sexually active.
Exactly. So the idea is to protect them before they become sexually active. But that doesn't mean that you're promoting promiscuity by vaccinating the children. Remember, irrespective of who you are, if a person is sexually active, even if the person has just got a single partner, there's still a risk of that person becoming infected with HPV.
Sure.
About 50 to 60% of people that are sexually active will actually become infected with HPV, irrespective of the more partners you've got, the greater the risk. But even if you just got a single partner, there's still a risk of becoming infected.
And it's spread quite easily.
And that's a problem. It's spread very easily. But now, like I said, we've got the tools that if you vaccinate before a person becomes sexually active, you're able to protect that person with the current evidence at least for 15 to 20 years, if not lifelong, against developing cervical cancer.
Inshallah, that will also make a huge change to the healthcare sector and the picture in South Africa. We're going to go for our last ad break, and inshallah, when we get back, I will be telling Shabir, Prof. Madhi, what my biggest problem is with vaccines. So I hope you wait for that. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. As we were saying before the break, vaccines have got many benefits. Obviously, there are some risks, and I was going to tell you what my biggest problem is with vaccination, and tell Professor Madhi. And Shabir, my biggest problem with vaccination is that we can't do it for some conditions. We can't do it for HIV, we can't do it for malaria, and it really would change the face of healthcare if we had a simple solution. I know it's not that simple, but a simple solution for some of these conditions, okay, which could really prevent these worldwide epidemics. I mean, if you look at Ebola at the moment, which is topical and, you know, controversial, but I mean, if you had a vaccine, it would really ease the fears that lots of people have.
Right. So the good news is that the vaccine for Ebola is pretty much on the horizon. Right. And Ebola is an easy virus to actually develop a vaccine against because it's a fairly stable virus.
Right.
But like you mentioned, the challenges we face is a vaccine against HIV. So people have been trying for over 20 years now to develop a vaccine against HIV. They've invested millions of dollars. Right? But the virus is such a tricky virus in that it's mutating all the time that it's really difficult to actually identify which component of the virus to target in terms of producing a vaccine against it. And that's the reason why we haven't been successful with an HIV vaccine.
Is there another way, Shabir? Because we've really been looking at one dimension of the immune system in terms of the antibodies. Is there a way to look at other aspects of the immune system which we can use to protect us or acquire immunity?
Not so much for HIV. I mean, the best we've got for HIV is to try to boost the immune system, and the way we do that is by giving people antiretroviral treatment.
Right, right.
That sort of re-establishes the immune system.
Right, right.
But in terms of prevention, I mean, what really works for HIV in terms of prevention is circumcision.
Yes, absolutely.
Male circumcision.
And I mean, safe sex and single partners and lifestyle change.
Right, so it's also, but male circumcision has probably been the single most important preventative strategy in terms of preventing HIV. You mentioned malaria. We do have a vaccine that's in the process of being licensed against malaria, but unfortunately it's a vaccine that doesn't have great efficacy, about 40% efficacy.
Right.
It protects about 40% of people that get it.
From falciparum, from the most severe type of malaria.
From the most severe form of malaria. But importantly, it protects children in the first year of life, which is when you get a most severe form of
malaria.
And
which is often deadly.
Which is, which causes most of the malaria death. But again, malaria is an example where we need to invest more in terms of trying to develop better vaccines.
And other preventative measures.
Correct, yes.
Okay, so I mean, we're almost done with time, and it's really been a very informative program for me. I mean, I've lost a lot of touch with what's been happening with vaccines over the years, and I think we just leaves us to thank Professor Madhi. But before he leaves, we're going to ask him to give us some final words and a take-home message about vaccinations and what he would say to the parents and the children out there.
I mean, the message to any parent is, if you truly love your child, right, do the responsible thing and get your child vaccinated as early as possible.
Right.
And then it's never too late it's never too late to vaccinate a child.
Okay.
So if for whatever reason children haven't been receiving their vaccines, it's never too late to actually take those children to clinics for the children to be vaccinated. And like I said, in South Africa, we've got this huge benefit of being able to leverage on one of the most progressive vaccine schedules anywhere in the world.
Well, they're not going to get into school without a vaccination
card
at the moment. So I think it's imperative that parents do the responsible thing, make sure their kids are looked after and vaccinated. And it's part of being a responsible citizen, contributing to the overall healthcare of society. It also means looking after your own children and protecting them. So I just want to thank Professor Madhi again. Jazakallah. Thank you very much for coming on, Shabir. It's really been very informative. And as usual, I'd like to wish all our listeners well. We pray that Allah SWT grants all those who are suffering and who are ill, who grants them shifa and keeps them well. And those who are not yet ill, we pray that Allah SWT protects them from illness, whether it's whatever means necessary, and keeps them as healthy and as well as possible. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.